neoliberal agenda, and they call it progress. We live in a country where going backwards is called progress. Michael said, poets with progress make no peace or pact. The act of poetry is a rebel act. And I want a logic to why poets stand with SYRIZA and Podemos and always with the poor. It's not just because we ourselves are always poor. It's because that is where the heart of who we are as a people. Any politics that does not respect the primacy of the interests of the poor is not a real politics and is doomed to fail. So, that's all very well, but I think we need a small bit of good humour as well. I'm sure lots of people here, like, I've been going to Greece for 30 years, I feel so at home there. That last time I went to Athens airport, I had my passport photograph, I have a beard. And the guy is looking at the passport, he's looking at me, so, and there's a characteristic gesture which I'm sure. And I went, and the guy handed me my passport, smiled and said, "Welcome back." And I always feel it. But there's a thing that happens. You're watching the ferries come in and out. You know, you go to the islands as I do. And you're watching the ferries go in and out. And there's always that lovely moment where the couple who have fallen in love for the first time in the history of humanity are breaking up. They're backpackers, often in America. They met in a backpackers hostel in Piraeus. She nearly fell under a bus. She got such a shock when she saw him. And he forgot to breathe. It's the first time anyone has ever fallen in love in the history of the world. The stars stopped moving in the heavens above them. Everything is perfect. And then after a couple of days, she thinks, "I wish he would laugh in that grating way." And he thinks, "Really, she should change her socks more often." Something small and trivial. And just as the ferry is coming in, they have the mother and father of all disastrous rows. Inevitably, in the cafe neons along the side of the jetty, the avid crowd is there to watch the comings and goings, and they have an audience for this little mini opera, right? So I saw this once and got an interesting lesson out of it. I should have stuck bits of paper in the book, but I was just teaching and I just lay it coming in. It's called Young Love. We've been watching them for the past half hour. Everyone has been watching them. The young Americans in their whirlwind of despair. Whatever picked them up in the world and held them together is no longer enough. It is the end of the dream, the end of love, the end of the world. The afternoon ferry bangs in, the ramp slams down. Everything now is bustle and heavy metal. Trucks roaring down the ramp, trucks roaring up. A tidal wave of grannies and locals and scooters sweeping in and out. What will they do, we ask? Stay or go? Nobody here in the Cafe Neon has drawn a breath for 5 minutes. When she grabs her impossibly heavy rucksack and drags it aboard without a backward glance, he stands there, stone, a monument to heartbreak. The siren blares, hoses splash in the water, the ramp drags over the hot concrete, a high metal screech, and then there is water between ramp and jetty, the gap opening, opening. We don't cheer the boy when he takes a running jump. We cheer Demetrius, Maria's boy, in his crisp white shirt, his first job as a man. Demetrius, who hangs from the chain at the ramp's edge and times the roar perfectly, his hand outstretched. Demetrius, 19 himself, a believer in love, and wiser than us with our stopped hearts, our misplaced pity for the young. Yeats has a great poem where a meditation in time of civil war, where one of the irregulars, as he calls them, comes to the door, an affable irregular, and it's kind of a smiling Republican. There were some even then, very little, there were some even then. And so, you know, it's always a surprise. I've 30 years or more, 40 years maybe, going to Greece. The number of places you will fetch up in a small island in a taverna somewhere and somebody will start quizzing you about Yeats and Kavanagh and Heaney and Durkin and me, and you never I never cease to be surprised. Just as we know our Cavafis, we know our Sephiris, we know our Odysseus, the latest. There is a lot of subterranean conversation going on between the two cultures, and very often it's being carried on in poetry. But this one, survivor, Athenian lawyer, on holiday here in the islands. I offer a cigarette. He pours two more brandies. The waiter is scattering bread on the water. We sit on in the lone light left burning. The subject is civil war. We have been talking about my poor country. He asks me to explain affable irregular when, in a lucid lurch of trust, I ask how it was here, under the colonels. He holds my eyes with his. He makes a fist, veteran and stern, the ring finger missing. So everything comes round. This poem is called Return to Hanya. It's about being an owl flip and going back to a place where you vaguely remember that you were young once and being reminded that everything comes round. I go a lot to an island called Ikaria in the Eastern Aegean. They call it the Red Island. And the last time, in 2012, it voted 86% between SYRIZA and Kukaha, between Communist Party and SYRIZA, 86%. We feel right at home there. It's like West Cork at 36 degrees. So there's always coming. It's kind of like West Cork at 36 degrees south. Ramshackle and perfect and absolutely independent. In fact, they had their own republic, just like the People's Republic of Cork. They had their own republic in 1912. And their own currency. And they negotiated joining the Greater Greece. So I have great fondness for Ikaria. It's a place I feel absolutely at home. But during the Civil War and during the time of the colonels, it was used as a political prison, because going back to the time of Solon and before that, the Greek autocracy has always had a habit of exiling its political opponents to the islands. And Ikaria, they decided there was no need to build a concentration camp on Ikaria because the whole damn island was so red there was no point. And they've kept that spirit going ever since. Mikis Theodorakis was sent there, and there's great photographs of them in an immaculate white linen suit with the hat, looking very suave and Athenian. And he'd been trained as classical composer. And in Ikaria, he met the sardonic working class songs of Athens and Saloniki, and the wild mountain music, the Dionysian mountain music, the traditional music of the island. And out of those three sources, he forged a new music for a new Greece. And it's still at the heart of the new Greece, is still that post, that unbroken post that says, we are not a state, we are not an economy, we are living, breathing people, and we love our liberty. And in every note that Theodorakis ever wrote, that's there. So, there I was, gone grey, and coming back to Hanya, because occasionally go to Crete, but mostly Ikaria. And suddenly, it was a kind of, you sense these things coming before you on the sunrise. Suddenly, that these kids are seriously confident and confidently serious. You could sense this new generation rising. Just like the new generation that's rising here, despite what the official commentators and David Davenport and the rest of them say, there is a new generation rising in here, and they're not going to take any bullshit anymore. That's coming. So here I am, come to Hanya again, but now suddenly full of years. The bronze girls go by in pairs, almost they walk through me. Am I a ghost in this evening air? This morning I woke in Piraeus to catch the boat and thought as I dressed of that other ferry I must take before long. Amazed, I hung between one mouthful of coffee and the next. Old bones, dear beating heart, how many laughing women once laid their faces to that pulse. Some are already gone to dust. Others are mysteries now, mothers, grandmothers. It has not been what we expected. It beggars breath to speak of it, such lives we have led, who were lithe as the bronze girls or the quick young men who thronged the square, eternity in their every breath and glance. I thought my life a catalogue of loss. Now, without meaning to, I see it all as gain. I am dizzy with hope, stunned. So much laughter and love, such joy come round again. When we make the revolution this time, it must be a revolution of joy. But let us not forget our own. When we find it in ourselves to build in the communities and in our workplaces and in our own personal lives, maybe with regard and reference to nobody at all, when we find it in ourselves to build a movement that will reach at last for the republic we never had, we have to remember we're not coming from nowhere. Just as SYRIZA comes out of a 2,000-year-old tradition of democracy, however imperfect we would now think, but just as the idea of liberty and hope has been kept alive generation after generation in Greece, so it has been kept alive here too. And it is important to remember always those who went before us. We may not agree with them. If we were there now ourselves, we might do things differently, but we owe a debt. We owe a debt to all those who gave their lives and their hearts and their minds and their time, that we might enjoy whatever liberty we enjoy now, that we might enjoy the liberty we can get built for ourselves. So 1991, in Kilmainham Jail, because the state had decided the best way to remember 1916 was to close their eyes, like bold children in a schoolyard, close their eyes and say it didn't happen, it didn't, it'll go away, it'll go away, it'll go away. We thought, that's not right. So it was the poets and the singers and the musicians who took over Kilmainham Jail and had a concert that night to honour, to remember the great dead, those who put their lives on the line for us, every one of us. And we'd somehow managed to get a hold of the tricolour that flew over Boland's Mills and the starry cloud that Constance Markovitz gave to Sean O'Casey, there but gave to the Citizen Army, precipitating Sean O'Casey's resignation, by the way, on the grounds that too much fuss was being made of this titled woman. Hope we're thinking more inclusively these days. And Frank Hart stood up to sing Paddy Calvin's wonderful song, and this is what happened. Hope I can remember. So from our history, from our tradition, to yours, in the unbroken struggle. Roadies in ponytails, stringing lights and cables. A beer can popped in the corner, echo of sound check. Outside, in the filling yard, hum of expectation. We pour through the narrow gate under the gallows hooked in twos and threes, becoming an audience. Before the light goes down, we examine each other shyly. The singer surveys his audience, heat rising to the tricolour and plough overhead, as the first words of Galvin's lament climb to invoke James Connolly's ghost. We are joined by the dead. I say this as calmly as I can. The gaunt dead crowded the catwalks, short-sleeved, disbelieving. The guards had long since vanished, but these looked down on us, their faces pale. I saw men there who had never made their peace, still stunned by gunfire, wounds, fear for their families, paralyzed until now by the long volleys of May sun. I think that we all felt it, their doubt and their new fear, the emblem so familiar, the setting, our upturned faces so unreal. Only the dignity of the singer's art had power to release them. I saw them leave in twos and threes as the song ended. I do not know that there is a heaven, but I saw their souls fan upward like leaves from a dry book, sped out into the night by volleys of applause, sped out, I hope, into some light at last. I do not know that I will ever be the same again. That soft-footed gathering of the dead into their peace was like something out of a book.